My name is Christoph Bellmann. I'm a senior research associate with the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development, the ICTSD. And it's a great pleasure to participate here as your moderator for this session organized by IFPRI. I'm sure you're all familiar with IFPRI, but for those who aren't, I think IFPRI will, over the 40 years? Roughly 40 years, has really been leading the kind of research-based policy solutions to address issues around poverty, around malnutrition, around hunger, as part of the CGIAR consortium. And I think it's fair to say that it has been one of the leading research outfits on many of these issues, including on issues related to trade, agriculture, and food security. So it's a real pleasure to have this session here. We at ICTSD have benefited from long-term collaboration with IFPRI, and it has always been intellectually challenging and rewarding. So I'm quite glad to be with you today. The topic that we have in front of us is equally challenging. Achieving food security by balancing policy space and policy disciplines at the international level, clearly a critical issue which I think it's fair to say that has been at the heart of the WTO negotiations in the area of agriculture, being on issues related to market access, to domestic support, to export subsidies. And I think basically it tries to deal with the issue of how unilateral policy intervention that are implemented in some countries to advance food security concerns or livelihood concerns or rural development concerns might actually affect third countries or global trade. And in a way, what is the role of international cooperation to deal with this kind of negative externalities while ensuring at the same time that countries don't compromise on their ability, basically, to pursue this objective of food security? What are the key issues? What are the trade-offs between having more policy space on the one hand or more disciplines on the other hand are needed to really manage this kind of collective action problems that we'll be talking about and achieve kind of mutually beneficial results? So that's pretty much the topic that we're trying to address, clearly a very important one. We'll have three very well-known and respected speakers. I'll just go one by one, and we'll introduce them as they start their presentation. First on my list is Will Martin, who's a senior research fellow at IFPRI, also president of the International Association of Agricultural Economists. He's been working for the last 6 years, leading research program at the World Bank on agriculture and rural development. Before that, I think he spent nearly 20 years working on trade policy and WTO issues also at the World Bank. So clearly a very well-qualified and respected expert. And what Will is going to do for us is, discuss the issue in general and then consider a few specific case studies of a collective action problem, namely in the use of price insulating policies to mitigate price spikes during the 2006-2008 food price spikes crisis. So with this introduction, over to you, Will.
Thanks very much, Christoph. It's a great pleasure to be here. This is my first of these ICTSD sessions, Trade and Development Symposia. Absolutely wonderful. Thank you. So balancing disciplines and policy space, as a joint presentation with David Laborde, I'd like to talk on four issues: the individual policy space and collective action problems, developing country growth and policies, a policy case study, that's the price insulation 2006-08, and then move to some policy options. So policy space and collective action. I think there are two types of collective action issues being addressed by the delegates over in the KICC. One is negative integration, the traditional sort of market access, export restrictions and so on, export competition. And that relates really to two issues, levels of protection, the height of tariffs or other barriers, non-tariff barriers, the restrictiveness, the variability of protection. And then I'll also talk about positive integration, things like trades facilitation, standards, very briefly. But primarily, negative integration, it involves restricting the measures used rather than developing new institutions. So typically, there are low or zero administrative costs or negative. I mean, if you get rid of non-tariff barriers, which create a lot of internal price volatility, then you lower administrative costs by replacing it with the sort of transparent tariff the WTO strongly favours. That raises performance both for the policy imposing country and its trading partners. Once good policies are in place, then further reductions in these negative externalities associated with protection come about by reductions in policy space. So that's essentially by lowering tariff bindings. That's essentially the key. That's the trade-off. You can't, with negative integration measures, you can't get reductions in collective action externalities, adverse externalities, without reducing policy space. Unilateral protection policies, what goes on, may make an individual country better off, you know, by improving its terms of trade. Lowering the price of imports or raising the price of exports. But that does so at the expense of others. That's the adverse externality. Or it might do this because of some politically influential interest groups that get a lot of rents from high protection. So collective action may improve on that outcome once you take into account the interests of others and bring export interests into the debate. You can likely get a better trade policy outcome that makes both parties or all parties better off. And that, of course, is the goal of the WTO. And that's why the WTO requires essentially unanimity for its approval of an agreement, because it wants everyone to be better off. It wants an outcome that's better off for everyone. But to do that requires trading off policy space for desired goals. And the WTO has a long experience in doing that, so seeking mutually agreed tariff bindings, for instance. Volatility doesn't receive as much attention in the WTO, but it's very, very important. Price insulation is awfully attractive to countries. So the world price goes up, as it did in 2006, 2008, put on an export ban, so your price doesn't go up as much. Lower your import duties. Actually, that was the most common response that countries took. More countries did that than put on export restrictions. But the problem with that insulation looks to work to every individual country, and I'll work through that example later. Collectively, it's pushing up the world price. That you're trying to hold down your domestic price, but at the same time, you're pushing up the world price. What happens then? Countries insulate more deeply. Because everybody else is insulating, the price becomes uncomfortably high for me, so I insulate as well, and it causes more countries to insulate. Positive integration, things like trade facilitation typically involves administrative costs, certifying standards have been met and so on. You need agreements, say, for compatible standards, but you don't really reduce policy space here. It's challenging because it doesn't, it doesn't reduce policy space. You don't have to take advantage of, say, a standards agreement, but it provides opportunities, and countries can choose whether to invest. But it's difficult for developing countries because it does require those investments. Developing countries' size and policies, size matters. I think this is a really important thing, and what we'll see, there's been a massive change here. Once upon a time, developing countries were very small in world agricultural trade. Other countries weren't interested in market access into developing countries. So what happened was the negotiations proceeded without strong participation by developing countries. We have the Jagdish Bhagwati Christmas tree model. Developing countries weren't required. They're like children. in that ancient model, and they weren't required to participate, and they benefited to some degree from what the industrial countries chose to do. But in developing countries' share of world agricultural trade has risen dramatically just in 20 years, just in the period when people were in the early 90s, when people were starting to think about finishing the Uruguay round and the future, the continuing agenda. At that point, nearly 40% of world trade in agriculture went from high-income country to high-income country. Industrial countries contributed 60% of world agricultural exports and 2/3 of world agricultural imports. Move on 20 years, this is trade excluding intra-EU trade, but it's fallen to 20%. Developing countries, trade involving developing countries is 80% of world agriculture. Talk about an absolute transformation of the world. So policies have also changed very, very much in developing countries. What you used to have was taxation of agriculture and a lot of insulation. You have, if you look at what happened, this is the work from Kim Anderson back in the 1950s. Industrial countries were already heavily protected, over 20%, and that protection just kept on rising until about the end of the Uruguay round. Partly because of the Uruguay round agreement, wasn't perfect, but it did contribute to declining protection in the industrial countries, a move away from border protection measures in particular. In developing countries, protection has been following the same sort of trend as in the industrial countries. The trend is very, very similar. The level is much lower. But now we have rising protection in developing countries. That's changing the fundamental architecture, creating serious collective action problems. One thing that happens with price insulation, the volatility of protection, what you see is that in developing countries, and this is the recent past, if you go back to January 2006, if you look at world prices, international prices of staple food, when you look at domestic prices in developing countries have stabilized domestic prices relative to world prices. But a lot of that has come about by developing countries using very strong price insulation, especially in this period, but then passing these impacts through. So that if you look, what's happening inside developing countries is very similar to outside developing countries. Insulation is a very short-run phenomenon of holding prices back down in response to higher prices outside, but that holding them down pushes up world prices much more. So price volatility and poverty, price surges are a huge concern in developing countries. The poor spend a lot of their income on food. Poor farmers are many poor farmers are net buyers. So policymakers strongly resist increases in world prices. So many people will argue in 2006, 2008, developing countries held prices down that must have helped the poor. And we know that higher food prices in the short run tend to raise world poverty. But the problem here with this insulation is that you end up with this beggar thy neighbor problem. Every individual country thinks its policies are a success, but by pushing up the world price, it's making it harder to hold down domestic prices. So the world price goes up. The policy of insulation is only effective if you are holding your protection down more than the average, more than the weighted average of protection changes. So the countries that insulate more than the average can hold down the domestic price relative to what would otherwise have happened. But that's a very, very strong condition. Clearly, not all countries can hold prices, can push their price, domestic price down more than the average country. Only some countries can do that, and we'll look at which countries did. And the other thing is, of course, effective insulation is much less than it appears. Because the effect of all this insulation is to raise prices, you're only really, this policy approach, very widely used policy approach, is only effective to the extent that you are holding down your price by more than the average. So the increase in the price of rice, the average increase in protection, which translates into a reduction in protection, which by restricting supplies to world markets and increasing demand is pushing up the price. The average is about a 40% increase in world prices, and that's the effect of that on world prices. So it's only if you're pushing down your price by more than that average that you will end up reducing the price rise in your country relative to what would have otherwise have happened. So you can see a set of countries here, Tajikistan through China, Belize, Nicaragua. These are the countries where prices were pushed down as a consequence of this policy. If you think of it as a collective policy, so these countries were able to push down their domestic prices more for rice, more than the average. Every other country, countries like India, who was pushing down the domestic price, but pushing it down by less than the average, was actually experiencing a rise in prices relative to what would otherwise have happened. So this collective action problem, there's only one case I can think of where everyone can be above the average, and that's the very famous case in the United States of Lake Wobegon, you know, where the women are strong, the men are good looking, and all the children are above average. Every country can't insulate by more than the average. So what we did with this, and this is for an for a recent study, we calculated the impacts of trade distortions in 2006 and 2008. We calculated the impacts of those on domestic and world prices and found that close to half of the increase in world rice prices came from this change in protection. We calculated the counterfactual policy implications and then calculated the poverty impacts, first of each country's policies alone, second of all of the collective action. when we do that, we use 31 countries' data household surveys. We looked at each country's own actions. So China thought it was lowering poverty by 0.6%, Cote d'Ivoire by minus 1.8. There was a total reduction in global poverty of about 84 million. So each country, each policy maker looked at the world price, looked at their own actions, and said, boy, this was a successful policy. But when you take into account the fact that the world price was pushed up and that many of the countries that insulated the most were ones where this really had no impact on poverty or maybe even increased poverty, when you look at that, what you find is that there was almost no change in global poverty. This policy, a lot of action, very policy action, but very little policy impact. So problems look successful even when it isn't. As I said, it's contagious. If other countries do it, I have to do it. Export restrictions particularly raise concerns about food availability and face next to no constraints from WTO rules. So three policy options: improving information, social safety nets, disciplines on collective action. Improving information, clearly very, very important. And of course, this is the one initiative that has come out of the 2006-2008 crisis. Really important, a lot to be done there. Social safety nets. Here you can really do a lot. Countries have done a lot. Takes a lot of time. Thanks very much. Takes a lot of work in advance. So it requires a lot of preparation. Terribly, terribly, but terribly important, and something that countries should continue, on which countries need to continue to work. With better identification measures and so on, there have been huge advances in what can be done with social safety nets. Unlike insulation, you don't get this increase, this incentive to substitute more towards food because it's cheaper, or to cut production because the price has fallen. Disciplines on production and insulation, on protection and insulation, that's of course is what the WTO is about. It's had some considerable success with things like the ban on variable levies in the Uruguay round. There is actually a cap in the price-based SSG and the price-based SSM on the extent to which policies can change in order to offset changes in external prices. So the idea is not completely alien to the WTO. So, yeah, it's needed to... I'm sorry. Yeah, I think this is a very, very important issue for the WTO, is to think about these collective action problems. It's not on the agenda, wasn't on the agenda before, except to the extent that you had the disciplines on variable levies. And of course, the concerns about the adverse impacts of higher export subsidies on world prices in the 80s. So to conclude, most WTO policies trade off policy space in order to achieve individual and collective goals. I think it's really important to remember that fundamental feature of the WTO or any other trade negotiation. I think the huge growth in developing country trade, as both in total, in aggregate, and as a share of world trade, completely changes the negotiating environment from the one that we saw even 20 years ago. Only 20% of agricultural trade is between the industrial countries. I mean, that's, you know, the idea that it's all about the US, EU, and Japan is very far gone. This is a wonderful thing, but it is going to influence the way policies evolve going forward. Uncoordinated use of price insulation is effective in reducing the impact of food price spikes in only a few countries, and not at all effective in reducing the impact on poverty. The really important thing, I think, to keep in mind is that what we want to look for, what we really need, is policies that are effective, policies that work. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Will. That was great. And you managed to keep to the time, so that was making my life easier. Let's move to our second speaker, Joe Glauber, another senior research fellow at IFPRI. Joe has spent almost 30 years at the U.S. Department of Agriculture, including as a chief economist. Between 2008 and 2014. He was also a special Doha agriculture envoy at the office of the USTR, and as such was the chief ag negotiator in WTO negotiations. So clearly with a very strong background, both on, I would say, on research and analysis, but also on negotiations, particularly in the context of the WTO. Joe will talk about crop insurance schemes in particular. Joe, you have the floor.
Thanks very much. One is agricultural insurance is a fairly new phenomenon. We've had agricultural insurance around pretty much since the 1930s. But in the WTO, at the time when the GATT round was, or the Uruguay round was initiated in 86, total insurance premium around the world was about $2 billion. In fact, a little less than $2 billion. Currently, it's around $35 billion and growing very, very rapidly. I mean, everyone's familiar with the U.S. program, which is the largest single program in the world. It's also one of the largest programs in the U.S., in the bundle of U.S. safety nets. So very, very important. But the U.S. isn't the only country that has large insurance programs. Japan and Canada have long had big insurance programs. In a survey done by the World Bank back in 2007, there were some hundred some odd countries at that time that had either crop insurance or some sort of agricultural insurance offered. And more recently, again, not just developed countries, but developing countries, China launched the program in 2007. Now premium volume on that program alone is over $5 billion. So very important. And one of the rationales that many people use about why insurance programs should be encouraged is the fact that under Annex 2 of the Uruguay Round Agreement on Agriculture, there are two paragraphs in there, paragraphs 7 and 8, that give policy space four programs of an insurance nature. One, paragraph 7 dealing with income insurance, paragraph 8 dealing with more standard yield insurance. Both of those paragraphs would allow producers to have those sorts of programs, and they wouldn't be exempt from reduction, or they would be exempt from any of the reduction disciplines, so-called green box. The interesting thing, and I think part of what this paper is all about, is despite that, despite having green box and oftentimes being touted as important for green box, in fact, countries very rarely use the green box to notify their support. Most of the insurance programs are notified as amber or not notified at all. I'm probably going to breeze through this because I have I could probably spend 45 minutes on all of this, but I'm going to go over briefly the negotiating history because I think that is important here, and then go through the provisions themselves, and then get into the growth of the insurance programs, and then talk about how they've been reported, and then significantly where insurance has come up in the WTO as well as in dispute settlement. And then finally we'll look forward a little bit. Well, one is the negotiating history itself. I don't need to go through this, but suffice to say that OECD had a lot of work on policies. That's how we ended up with a lot of the domestic support disciplines. They came out of that research. The Uruguay round was launched in 86. One of the first proposals out of the box was the US, who said, put all those insurance subsidies in the amber box, they aren't green. And pretty much every country was aligned with that. But as the negotiations progressed towards 1990, all of a sudden people were including disaster programs, and by virtue of that, also crop insurance programs. The DiZeo text, which came out in 90, excluded crop insurance from reduction, and that was embedded essentially in the Dunkel text, and as we see what finally in the agreement on agriculture. Again, one key thing here is this, as we'll see in a minute, is the exemption from countervailing duty. The Dunkel text would have exempted crop insurance subsidies from countervailing duty, and what, by the time the Uruguay Round Agreement on Agriculture came by, they were not. They weren't exempt. Okay, well, again, I said there's two basic paragraphs. One, paragraph 7, and you can see the criteria to how to meet an insurance program needs to meet the green box criteria. A 30% loss is required. The income guarantee has to be established over a three-year average or a five-year Olympic average. It's essentially a whole farm policy, and then it can't give you more than what the production is actually worth. Similarly, paragraph 8, which again covers yield loss, here it says that it's based on a 30%, the policies have to include a 30% production loss, again, compared to a three-year average. It requires a disaster declaration and cannot, again, like the other, can't make you more than whole. The interesting thing for implications here is the fact that, one, these things are pretty much at odds with how people, a lot of people have constructed their insurance programs. One is that most insurance programs for yield rates and yield guarantees or revenue guarantees are based on much longer yield histories in the case of a yield, or they're looking at prospective prices taken off futures prices. They aren't looking at short-term three-year averages or five-year Olympic averages. A five-year Olympic average, obviously, where you throw out the high and low year. The paragraph 8 has this interesting thing where you have to have a disaster declaration. But clearly with insurance products, someone always has a loss, even in really good years. And then I think that the bigger thing is that over time, you've seen this vast evolution of insurance products not just yield products, but also revenue products based on futures prices. You see area-based and weather-based insurance products, which are very typical in developing countries now, and then margin products that pay on the difference between output and input prices. Here's what I was showing you, or talking about, this big increase in insurance premium volume, and the two largest insurance programs, China's and the U.S., over time. Just a rapid increase since 2000, and no sign that's slowing down. In the U.S. program, there were a number of various acts that really propelled the program, and there's plenty of articles on that that are cited in the paper on this. But the other thing I wanted to show is the one on the right, and that just shows the growth of revenue programs. And there, if you look at those things are actually reversed. Those should be $1 billion on the left and million acres on the right. But that's area, and you can see that on the right. And that yellow bar just shows how much of policies now in the U.S. are revenue-based rather than yield-based. So the issues on how to notify crop insurance, should they be green or amber? Should they be product-specific or non-product specific? How are they measured? We've measured a whole bunch of different ways, premium subsidies, by looking at net indemnities, looking at net indemnities times percent of subsidized premium, some very complicated issues here. And then the other thing is how they end up being notified. If you look at how delivery costs are being notified, because in many countries, the private sector, private companies deliver these, but at a subsidy. The government will subsidize the delivery of the products. And so how are those, are they considered part of the domestic support to farmers? Or are they just considered support for delivery like any other implementation cost of a program? And then I would say that looking through in the extensive survey of work done, most countries lack transparency. It's very difficult to get data on crop insurance in terms of in many agricultural insurance in many countries. Well, this just shows you how some of the selected notifications under paragraph 7. Again, this is the income insurance. Most of these are actually more relief programs, not insurance programs per se. Canada has a whole farm stabilization scheme that their numbers are show up there. And Russia, just at least in the last 2012 notification, which is only their second notification, of course, they reported at least their insurance programs as income insurance under paragraph 7. If you look at paragraph 8, the more the bigger portion of the pie, what's done for agricultural insurance, either in crop or revenue, you see that U.S., for example, shows up in amber. Japan splits up policies that have 70% yield coverage or less into the green box, and for those over 70%, they put that into the amber box. Canada, all their crop insurance program shows up amber, and pretty much across the board, if you get into a couple of developing countries for those years reported, both Brazil and India report theirs as green. China has not yet reported their crop insurance program. And then you have countries like Mexico, which have reported under Article 6.2, the so-called development box. Let's move through this. It's just to say that there are some very important things when one is trying to measure the insurance subsidy. In one sense, one looks at things like the net indemnity, that is the premium that's paid by the producer. You look at that relative to what they get year in and year out. In a program where those premium are set to where they're set on an actuarially fair basis, that equates to essentially the premium subsidy. And frankly, the premium subsidy is a better way of measuring it because it's something you know it at the outset, that at planning time. In some years, of course, if you have good years, you may have very little indemnities and actually have a negative support, or in large years, you have very large outlays. And so the premium subsidy is a much fairer way of getting at the ex ante, that is at the time of planning, what that support is providing. The other thing is looking at is what exactly the net benefits are if you include premium costs. And here all I did was I looked at the U.S. program and I said, well, let's first take what the producer loss ratio is. And all that is the indemnity paid to the producer in a given year relative to what premium he or she paid. And you can see that those have varied and been quite high. The U.S. program is very heavily subsidized. If you put on top of that the so-called Hazel ratio, which was developed by Peter Hazel when he was at IFPRI many years ago, that includes delivery costs, and you can see there that adds even more. But It's a difficult measure because, one, these programs probably wouldn't even exist in the absence of subsidies. That is, or they would exist in very different forms, I think. They're very costly programs, not just in the U.S., but in other places. And so trying to count this, should this be counted as a subsidy to the insurance industry or a subsidy producer is a more difficult task. So let me talk briefly about some trade disputes where cotton has come up, crop insurance has come up is the Brazil cotton case. One normally doesn't think of that because the focus on the Brazil cotton case was on particularly the price-based subsidies like the old counter-cyclical payment program, the marketing loan payment. But there were two basic determinations that the panel was forced to. One was this so-called peace clause analysis, and there they had to look at crop insurance subsidies to see if the total amount of subsidies provided to the U.S. cotton program exceeded that was in place in 1992. Under the old Uruguay Round Agreement, the peace clause language, which expired in 2000, but at the time the Brazil cotton case was launched, was very much in effect, said you can't take a case against a country, you can't take them to the WTO on a subsidies and countervailing measures dispute if the support provided to that commodity is less than what was provided in 1992. So the panel had a look at this, and indeed they looked at crop insurance subsidies and said, these are crop specific. They aren't germane to everyone. You can look and see the very specific subsidies that are going to cotton. And then they looked at, in fact, Brazil had put forward measuring cotton as a premium subsidy, and the panel accepted that. Then when they got to serious prejudice, that is actually where, what's the effect of these programs? And while the panel did find against the counter-cyclical payment, did find against a number of other market price-based programs, they determined that the crop insurance program, because they found their finding is it wasn't price contingent, and they were looking at sort of the yield aspects of crop insurance, it was determined to be more income support for income rather than direct price support. Now, the issue, of course, is that over time, these policies have moved much more rapidly to revenue policies, and many would argue that, in fact, that far more vulnerable crop insurance or revenue insurance programs would be far more vulnerable using this sort of analysis. And moreover, there's some appellate body ruling that suggests that subsidies themselves have to be taken into account regardless of whether or not they are essentially income support or price support. I might add there's also been a number of CVD actions against the U.S., three from Canada against corn subsidies, and these were, again, largely launched against the price and income support programs for that the U.S. had for the corn program. But crop insurance was included in that mix, and again, recall that insurance subsidies, one way or the other, aren't even green box wouldn't be considered exempt here. And then China was another one that launched a countervailing duty action against U.S. poultry, but there they said, well, the inputs to poultry production, corn and soybeans, they're heavily subsidized with all these price and income support programs. And with that, too, crop insurance was brought in. And it just suffices to say that both of these, in all of these cases, they found crop insurance to be very specific to that commodity. They measured it in different ways, depending on, and even over time. I think the Canadian ones at one time didn't add indemnities, other times looked at premium subsidies. Both China and the latter Canada case included delivery costs, but when looking at the effects of the subsidy, then that's where it washed. And in terms of the Canada corn cases, less impact. And then again, here not an issue of green box or not. It's really the nature of the subsidy. I'm going to try to close real quickly. There's a large literature, mainly dealing with the U.S. crop insurance program, because there's a lot of data available for the U.S. crop insurance program. that looks at this issue of, does subsidized insurance create risks? Does it provide incentives to grow on marginal lands? Does it provide incentives that give some crops larger advantage over other crops? And there, I think the literature, there's now quite a large body. And I think for the U.S. program, at least, what it says is that looking at the cropping decisions, they're pretty small, except when you look in the case of not surprising, where you have a subsidized insurance, a crop that has subsidized insurance available versus a crop that's either versus crops that have no insurance. So in some cases, you saw where there might be a hay crop where insurance was not offered in that county, and then that was competing against, say, a wheat crop where there was subsidized insurance. And sure enough, in those counties, there was a very a large effect. But in the main, in terms of looking at the large aggregate effects in the U.S., fairly small. And similarly with looking at the impact on marginal lands, some, but again, fairly small. I think most of this, or two takeaways from this is, one, these are the U.S. program is very large, and almost every crop receives this subsidy. So the trade-offs there, I think, are difficult to get empirically to coax much out of there. And I think the issues where there is very convincing evidence is if you have a program that's not subsidized and you have a program that's subsidized, there is an impact. So again, that's something to remember, at least when you're looking larger at the issue of, if you introduce a crop insurance program that's subsidized, will that impact have some impact on cropping? And I think the answer is yes. But then the other thing is that a lot of these studies were done in the late 1990s, early 2000s, and that one chart I had showed you the large increase that occurred post 2000. And so I think there's a lot of work that's ongoing right now looking at that issue of whether or not this is going to be an issue. Just to show you sort of what the level of subsidies are as a percent of the value of production, you can see that varies by commodity. You have corn fairly low, corn and soybeans and rice less than 5%. For some of the other commodities, highly variable, I might add. These are crops that are grown in more difficult, more risky areas, areas that are dry land, more variable yields. And because of that, premiums are larger and premium subsidies as a result. So both cotton and wheat at those larger ones. And these are I'd say these are probably five of the six or seven most important crops and probably account for about 85% of total premium in terms of crop insurance. This just makes that point where you can see that in terms of dollars per acre and as a percent of premium, what do I mean by that? That looks like I need to move over one decimal point. In any event, just to say the subsidies have gone up considerably over the last several years. And I think that again, looking forward, and I'm going to close here, is that the issue is, well, should one consider making changes in the current Annex II? If no one's using this box, if no one's using this policy space, should one consider changes? Rev 4 does have some changes that meet this whole issue of, should you use a three-year average or a five-year average? Rev 4 had changes that said, well, you should base that on principles of actuarial soundness. It also has some changes that were put in for developing countries to allow for coverage levels greater than 70%. It also has a number of things for things like coverage for plant and animal quarantines, which have become obviously very important too. Revenue and margin products, should there be need for more refined language there? And then lastly, the growth of index-based products. These are weather derivatives, things based on area yields, based on a whole number of of contingent products. In most of these cases, the 70% coverage level actually for an area-based product occurs very seldomly, unless you're in a highly, highly variable land. So there's some that would say to get equivalent coverage to the 70% at an individual level, that perhaps needs to be pushed up. I think in the best of all worlds, this is something, rational people would sit around a table and show evidence and do this. I think, unfortunately, in a negotiation-based thing, is awfully tough. So I'm going to conclude there. I've gone on way too long, but thanks so much. And I might add that all three of these papers are going to be available in an electronic book that IFPRI will be putting out, I think, early in 2016, and with a whole lot of other trade-based articles. So with that, Christoph.
Thanks a lot, Joe. I think it was a great presentation. In the interest of time, let me move immediately to our third presenter, Eugenio Diaz Bonilla, who's a visiting senior research fellow at IFPRI. Eugenio has worked for a number of years as executive director for Argentina and Haiti at the Inter-American Development Bank. He has been a consultant, staff of the World Bank, UNDP, FAO, involved also in negotiations for the Argentinian government on agriculture and trade issues. Eugenio is going to talk about public stock holding for food security purposes. And as you know, this is one of the most controversial issues in the negotiations. Over to you, Eugenio.
Thank you very much, Christoph. We've been collaborating with ICTSD for a long time, a very fruitful collaboration. So we hope to continue doing that. Thank you very much for chairing our session. I'll talk about the background of this debate about food security stocks, then some legal issues, then economic and operational, and then some conclusions. First, as a background, of course, food security is not a new concern. It's been throughout. The point is how the food security concerns may appear. In 2008 was this special safeguard mechanism that it's still with us, and at Bali was the food security stocks that the issue is still with us. And it was mostly because, I think, a change in circumstances. Because we had high prices, then the problem of comparing the actual market prices in dollars that were far higher with a measure that was defined as 86, 88 average, because prices were high in the market, then a problem with the gap between these two prices appeared, and I will get back to that. But the problem is that the cycle of high prices and low prices, it seems to be repeating. We had a arch of 10 years in the 70s, and it ended up with commodities being low in the mid-80s. Probably we are, of course, history never repeats itself the same way, but we sort of have the same arch with high prices, high growth, et cetera, a lot of different factors that led to the spikes. And now we have all those factors working in reverse. We have slow growth, technological change in energy. That's happened the same in the 80s, but a different type of technology in energy. The biofuels are now stabilizing, and we have the only question mark is whether climate shocks may keep on continuing disturbing the supply side. But on the demand side, I think it's the cycle is coming down. And I'm not going to just – this is growth over the last 50 years, and this doesn't show. Well, anyway, the red line is the growth per year. The broken black line are the projections of the International Monetary Fund. But the other numbers are either we can revert to the average, which is 2.8 growth. Or we can keep on continue go down. I think we are rather going down. 2016, 2017 will going to be a 2 years in which the world cycle will happen again. Mainly because of huge accumulation of debt. I'm not going to comment on this. And the other thing that is working in reverse now, this is the inverse relationship between the dollar value. When the dollar is overvalued, commodities are undervalued because they are measured in dollars, so they move opposite. And this is the current situation. The dollar is getting overvalued, and therefore the commodities go down. And finally, this is the production of biofuels. It's in Spanish, so I apologize, but the thing is that during 4, 5, 6 years, we have this ramp up in demand because we had to move from zero mandate to 10%. But once you get 10%, the famous blend wall, then you just move with the demand of gasoline. And so we are on the blend wall, so there's not going to happen again this big jump up in demand. So basically, we are in a different cycle now. And if we look at these are the two lines are the nominal food prices indices in US is the blue line, and in special drawing rights, which is a basket of currencies that the IMF calculates, you can see that if we measure in special drawing rights, which is a currency, is far lower than in dollar terms. In dollar terms, was affected by several things, including the depreciation of the dollar. And now we see the coming down. The broken lines are the average, the 86, 88 average in these two measures. So what you can see is that for dollars, the average still higher, the 2015 nominal price is still higher than the average 86, 88. But if you measure in special drawing rights, it's getting far closer. And this is going to be crucial for some of the legal aspects that I'm going to comment. So the basic implication of these high prices was that if you have to, according to the Agreement on Agriculture, you have to multiply, you have to look at your administered price, so the price that the government says is going to pay to the farmers, and you have to compare it to the fixed external reference price 86, 88, but the market itself is very high, as it happened during 2008, 2011, then even though you may be not paying more than the market, it will look like you are giving a subsidy according to the legal rules to farmers. And that created the problem, in my view, of the first discussion about this notional gap without meaningful economic implications is what led to the problem that India presented. So, therefore, to understand the legal issues, we need to understand what the Annex II says. And the Annex II has one fundamental requirement, which is not being trade distorting, whatever you do in Annex II, which is the green box, and then two basic criteria. One, the funding must come from the government, and second, whatever you do, it cannot be given price support. So if you do not, if your alleged green box measure do not comply with these three fundamental requirements and two basic criteria, will not be a green box. And the proposal, in paragraph three, in annex two, that you can buy at market prices, no problem. But if you use administered prices, you have to compare to the fixed external reference price, which is 86, 88. Selling can be done at subsidized prices. People say, it's unfair that India cannot have a food stamp program like the U.S. Yes, it can. It can subsidize the poor. It's footnotes 5 and 6. The question is how you buy, not if you give subsidies to the poor. And we have then the G33 proposal, which is based in 2008 modality Rev 4, that if you buy from low-income or resource-poor producer, then will not be counted as a distorting, and you have not counted against your aggregate measure of support. That was in Rev 4, but the problem is that basically you are violating one of the two basic criteria in the green box. Once you open up that Pandora box, then anything can happen in the green box, and then what is left of the green box no one will know. And the other concern is that you may lead to subsidized export that may be affecting food security in other countries. Then it was very difficult to resolve, as you all know, the discussion in Bali. So it was basically a peace clause that protects developing countries only that had existing programs for traditional staple food crops. And then there is a footnote explaining what that means, that in fact changes completely the meaning of what it says in the text. You are protected from complaints under Agreement on Agriculture. You're not protected from complaints and the agreement of subsidies and countervailing measures. And you have to comply with a lot of different other things, which the most important of which are transparency. You have to notify and inform about what you are doing. Then the peace clause had an ambiguous wording because it said that the WTO members must find a permanent solution, and it had to find it in two ministerial, so not this one, but the next one, 4 years from Bali. So, but this is different. One thing is, if everything is in place until you have a permanent solution, it doesn't have an end. When it happens that you have a permanent solution, it ends. But if you have a deadline, which is two ministerials, then it's 4 years. So that ambiguity is what India wanted to clarify in the with the second resolution, and basically it clarifies that, you know, permanent solution is not a temporary solution. It's an interim solution, which it seems to be very critical, meaning that until that permanent solution happens, there is no deadline. So basically, now we have in that, this is the situation right now. Still, you have to notify explain what you are doing with your food security stocks, and then products covered, it's not clear because in the footnote, in the text says food crops, in the footnote says primary agricultural products. Agricultural products may include livestock then. It doesn't necessarily mean only crops. But on the other hand, it says predominant staples of traditional diet. So it's not clear to me what the coverage of the products is. And as I said, can be challenged under the agreement on subsidies and countervailing measures. So now the question is, we need to work to a permanent solution. So I'll be working through different options, some easier and to the more difficult, if you want, in the legal text. First, as I said, developing countries can give subsidies to the poor, period. The problem is how you buy. Then you can buy at market prices, like Brazil, US, they do that. You know, they buy at market prices. That in itself, counterfactually, gives some support to agriculture. Because you are giving, you are creating aggregate demand that would not have existed otherwise, because poor people may not have had the money to buy. Therefore, when you buy and then give it to the poor, you are creating aggregate demand that wouldn't have existed. So you are giving some price support by using market prices, if you want. Then the other thing is, what does it mean, eligible production? The Korean beef case explained that it's not total production. There is a paper by Frank Galtier calculating the implicit bias in these calculations, but he uses permanently total production. In fact, you can define, if you carefully define what is the amount of production that you buy, and in the case of the Korean beef, the problem was not, the problem is that they define an amount, but then the Korean government only notified what they were buying. It was not, in any case, never was the total production what was at stake. So you can define eligible production in a way that can reduce the amount, because you have to multiply the gap times the eligible production, so that reduces what may appear as a aggregate measure of support or AMBER, a price support that you need to include in the aggregate measure of support. Then also you can use the equivalent, the calculation of price support is not practicable. There is a discussion, what does it mean that it's not practicable, but still that may be one of the options. Then the other issue is, you know, how you work on reference price. And again, the Korean beef case clarified this. Some people were saying, no, if you had in your constituent data and methodology, you put your prices in domestic currency, then you cannot change. But the Korean case, it said that in accordance means that you need to do it according to the Annex 3, which defines how you have to do these calculations. But it doesn't say, but it says taking into account the constituency methodology and so on. So conceivably, you can, even if you did it in domestic currency, the first fixed external reference price, you can change it to dollars, and I would argue you can change it to special drawing rights, and you can change it to constant currency, because some of the countries, at least one country, and notified originally in constant local currency. So basically that takes care of the inflation and devaluation and so on and so forth. And there was a paper by the ISTSD of Montemayor that he was doing different calculations. And in fact, all the countries that he looked at and all the products that he looked at, if you define quantities in a more restricted way and you use dollar external reference price, no country had a problem meeting the, you know, they were all below the 10%, the minimum for the product, so they didn't have a legal problem with the WTO. Then you can have the issue of adjustment by inflation. You cannot adjust by inflation yourself. You need to go back and change the fixed external reference price. I'm not going to enter into the details of that. Then there is my proposal, which is basically if you are buying, even if your administered price is at or close to the market price, then you could be rebuttably presumed to be in compliance. You know, people can say, you know, you are not in compliance, and then they will have to prove it instead of, but it has to be close to your import parity price, and then certainly you cannot export. If you are saying that you are accumulating food stocks for food security reasons, then you cannot turn around and export that basically with a subsidy. So there are other, what I'd say, not good ideas, but in any case, these are potential legal options to consider. The question is more, I would say, and this is a schizophrenic, you know, we have the legal aspects totally unrelated from the economic and operational aspects. Something can be legally acceptable under the WTO and doesn't make any sense in economic terms. And so it's important to separate these two aspects. I would argue that there is this sort of unidimensional approach where I would argue it's wrong, that basically goes, you know, you need food security to stabilize prices because it's important for food security. In fact, you have a lot of policies, not only food security stocks, that can help stabilize prices, and you have a lot of other things besides stabilization of prices that affect food security. So if you're going to consider food security stocks, then you need to put it in the context of an overall program for food security. And then you can discuss whether it makes sense to use food stocks, public food stocks, to help with that food security problem. And inevitably, you get into this problem that Timmer, Pearson, and Falcon discussed in 1982-83 food policy book by the World Bank, which is basically all the governments want high prices for the producers and low prices for the consumers. You know, you cannot have both. This is the basic food policy dilemma. And the only way to solve it is to increase productivity and profits of producers and then make affordable the prices. But then you need more than one instrument, either the food stocks, protection, liberalization. You need several instruments because at least you have two objectives. And the other, this I expand more in a book that I just published in October, what I call the Bhagwati rule. If your problem is A, then your policy has to address A. If your problem is food security, that's an individual problem. So you cannot look at crops. Even if you call it food security crops or whatever, the problem is with the people. So if you are concerned about food security at the individual level, you make sure that the people have income to buy the food. Even if you stabilize prices or whatever, at least once or twice removed policy instrument with respect to your objective, which is basically people. Then you need to consider your food security stock. What is your objective? Usually, policymakers tend to define a lot of objectives. But then you need to understand exactly what you want to do with this food security stock. It's an emergency stock, then it has its own rules. It's a food security stock that basically is a backup for a distribution system, like in the case of India, or it's a price stabilization scheme. Each one has its own rules and functions, and you cannot mix all of them without having problems, basically fiscal and operational problems later. And if you're concerned about the poor, usually it's far more effective to have food safety nets. And if you're concerned about the producers, have a full poverty-based income support for everybody that is poor, being a consumer or a producer. You need a safety net based on poverty requirements and not look at the price of wheat or rice or whatever, because in my view, you need to separate the efficiency aspects, which markets take care of, but they don't take care of the equity issues. The equity issues are separate, and that those are more like moral decisions by the government, by the society. So you can give income support based on poverty issues to the poor producers if you want, and then you can use some of the instruments that you have. So in conclusion, I think you have a lot of different potential legal solutions to the problem, and I think that with prices going down, it's going to disappear as a problem, but that's a separate issue. And as I said, the idea of food security products is a bad idea in itself because they are not food security problems. They are food security problems of people. If you work on crops, you will not solve the problem of people. And usually, many of the problems are macroeconomic, inflation, that leave the poor behind, exchange rate crisis, and so on. Ethiopia had, during the height of the 2008-2011 crisis, domestic prices in Ethiopia were higher than the world prices because of the exchange rate problems and the way they were managing the exchange rates. So even if they had stabilized the price of the product, they would have had a lot they destabilized the price of the product because of the exchange rate problems that they had. And the other point to also consider is that there is some research by IFPRI showing that nutrition diversity is far more important to reduce stunting and wasting than calories per se. So if you have a food security stock based on one product, may make sense in Indonesia. 50% of the calories come in Indonesia from rice. But there is a very recent work IFPRI on food security stocks for Sudan, South Sudan, the new country. They have four products that are important. So you need to stabilize all four. And you have in Latin America, you have huge diversity of different products that give your calories and minerals and so on and so forth. So to the extent that nutritional diversification is more important, then this issue of one or two food security crops doesn't make much sense. And at the same time, the fact that supermarket revolution, the expansion of supermarkets is opening up new ways in which food gets very much into the rural areas as well, then you need to think what's the cost benefit of having a public distribution system when you have an expanding private sector. Still, it may make sense to have some food stocks for emergency reasons and to back up some of the big redistributive programs, like in the case of India, may make some sense. But usually the problems of the food security stocks are not legal. You have room in the WTO, in my view, to do whatever you want. The problem is economic and operational. And basically, in the case of India, I see two conflicting narratives, and I finish with that, Christophe, which is, you know, on the one hand, India is the second exporter of beef after Brazil in volume. It's a big exporter of rice, of wheat, on the one hand. So you're a food exporter. Why are you claiming food security problems on the other hand, you have a lot of poor people, your producer average is two hectares, and so on. So you do have this sort of duality in your system. And the public distribution system in India moved from 600 million to more than 800 million, and it's the largest system of food security or transfer for consumers. But it has a lot of problems, excess of stock, procyclicality, subsidized export, large fiscal cost, they do not translate in an equivalent support to poor consumers. So, but on the other hand, India has avoided any food crisis since the last 40, 50 years. So you can understand why this duality in the structural production on the one hand, and the fact that they, with this system, even though with all the inefficiencies and corruption and leakages and blah, 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 they didn't have a food problem, a food crisis for the last 40, four, five decades. So my point is, give time to India to move to something more reasonable. The European Union had a long time to move out of the worst aspects of the common agricultural policy. The US also had time to change some of it. Now it's reverting back to some of the bad things, perhaps. But so give time to India, but at the same time, I think we need to keep on working. And there are legal options, and in my view, prices are going to come down, and therefore some of the big problems with the fixed external reference price will disappear. Thank you.
Thanks, Eugenio. I think we've had three very good presentations that looked at different aspects, some more related to market access, other more related to crop insurances, stock holding. Let me now maybe open the floor for comments, discussions. If you can just raise your hand, I'll collect a few ones and then I'll go back to our speakers. Please. A micro will come.
Hello. My name is Hildegunn Gjengedal and I work for the Norwegian Farmers Union. And food security is also an issue in Norway, even though we're not a poor country. We import 50-60% of what we eat. So it's also an issue. And you've been talking a lot about every country's policies on these themes. But I wonder if you could have some reflections on the global food security and the need to have a production in spread out in different countries and not being too dependent on importing products to different countries of the world, taking into consideration climate changes and the need to other reasons to have food production in every country and how that will be affected. Thank you.
Yes, I think very, very, very important aspect, global food security. Let me take another one, and maybe we'll go back to our speakers after that.
Okay, thank you very much for the good presentations. I'm Peter Mwagi from KEA, that is Kenya Agribusiness and Agroindustry Alliance. And my question goes to Joe, particularly the issue of the crop insurance. He has given a very good comparative analysis of developed countries and with a focus with countries like Australia, US, and Canada. And what would be the position of the developing countries in relation to this? Because it's a very new concept within this negotiation.
Thank you very much. My name is Christine Wieck from the German Development Corporation, advising the German Ministry for Development. A factual question for Mr. Diaz-Bonilla regarding defining the fixed external reference price. Can the country still now define this price, or was it only possible during the Uruguay round? And then my other more general question is, so if they can so they are not possible, it's not no longer possible for them to use it. So then my question would be with respect to the policy space as you have shown under either insurance policies or also this Annex 2 Article 5 policies, which would be direct payments. These are all very costly policies. So if developing countries think about providing crop insurance for maybe 30-50% of their smallholders or 30-50% of the population, which are smallholders, how can they finance them? Even if we think that, as Mr. Glauer has shown, that a lot of these policies were notified as amber box, so these developing countries, these low-income countries, often do not have the amber box available, so they only have the de minimis option for amber box. And then my question is, would that fit into that, and is this really a policy option for them? Thank you very much.
Thanks. I'm just looking at the time. So in the interest of time, what I'll do is I'll take these other two questions, then we'll go back to our speakers, and if time allows, we might go for a second round. So the lady in the front.
Thank you very much, Christoph. Marita Wigatale from Oxfam, Germany. I would just have one question. I'm sorry, I couldn't follow all the presentations, so apologize if you have said that already. But I was wondering, I mean, looking at world agricultural trade and agreements overall, What would you say are the biggest problems that developing countries face if they want to ensure food security? What are the biggest problems that are existing on the ground?
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you very much. Desmond McNeil from the University of Oslo in Norway. A very broad-ranging question. To what extent is what you've been saying be different if you were talking about the new mega trade and investment agreements? To what extent would some of the points you've been making be very different if you were talking about the implications of the new mega agreements rather than the current WTO regulations?
Okay. So a very rich and interesting set of questions, some directed to certain speakers, but what I suggest we do is we just go through all the speakers and feel free to touch upon whatever question you want to address. And let me start by Will.
Thanks very much, Christoph. I'll address the first question, so I think the others were mostly specific. I agree with you that what we want is diversity, diversification. The worst possible world is one where every country is self-sufficient. And that's autarky. That's guaranteed to be a much more food price volatile. The output volatility for an individual country is always going to be bigger, almost always, bigger than the volatility for the world as a whole, because you have different weather conditions, different opportunities, different incidences of disease, and so on. There's a wonderful natural experiment performed by Burgess and Donaldson, Dave Donaldson, who looked at what happened when rail was introduced to particular parts of India. Before the railways, food transport costs were enormously high. You had droughts, you had floods, you had massive food insecurity, you had famine reports were carefully kept. And what happened was, when the rails came, you had the ability to move food to the areas that needed it, and the incidence of famine reports, famines just fell like a stone. I mean, just diversity is really, really good. Autarky is a miserable, terrible place to be stuck because of the volatility of output, which is the main source of volatility in food supplies, can lead to the most diabolical outcomes. What you really want is diversity in the areas from which people can access food. And that's what you get with an interconnected, a globalized system. I'm not saying there's no role for trade policy at all. But the worst possible outcome is autarky. I think it's very important to keep that in mind. What a horrible, dreadful place it is if you don't have trade available to you.
If I may just add, in and I've used my position while we're on this topic, because afterwards we'll move to another one. So what the OECD and the FAO tell us is that what we're likely to see in the future is actually more concentrated exports. In other words, a larger number of countries relying on imports, but a smaller and smaller amount of countries that are actually providing those exports. So what would be your? I mean, that would probably go against what what you would like to see, in the sense that you were just arguing in favor of having as many possible kind of providers of food elsewhere. So, are you concerned by this concentration that we're seeing on the export side?
Certainly, exporters are the number of major exporters is a much smaller set of countries. And of course, what's going on is agricultural resources are very, very widely distributed. So most production is still occurring in the countries in which it's consumed. But you're going to see, you have seen the emergence of Brazil as a major exporter in the last 20 years. And you've seen growth in Argentina. I hope, there's certainly the potential for Africa to become a major exporter. I haven't actually looked at the projections that you mentioned, Christoph, so I'd love to look at that. But I mean, just that general point to keep in mind, is that the resources are quite widely distributed, and it's the food that you can access that really matters. And so I think that's an absolutely central principle. I'd have to have a look at the specifics. It may be with climate change that you may also get some shifts. You know, we've seen the emergence of the Black Sea Basin as an exporting region. It was formerly an importing region under the Soviet Union. So I'd expect to see things continue to move around. I'd be surprised if the shifts are big enough to create a lot of food price volatility. What creates a lot of food price volatility is the prices of the attempts to insulate that will double the price volatility in rice, for instance, the size of price movements in rice. So that's the sort of thing that I worry about, that leaves countries worried about whether they can rely on markets.
Well, before moving to crop insurance, let me just finish on one point here, and that is, if you look at the projections, and I think a lot of us have looked at those projections by FAO and OECD, where you see the growth in demand is Africa, where the potential for growth in production is also Africa. So it's clear that South America, particularly Brazil, Argentina, others will continue to be very, very large suppliers and grow in importance, as will the Black Sea area grow in importance, but Africa too. And there I think the importance that I see is growth of intra-regional trade, because clearly this you're talking about moving grain from, even in a country like Nigeria, moving grain from agricultural regions to Lagos, into the large cities, I'm also making a pitch. Will and I were just on a panel earlier this week on an initiative to improve trade monitoring within Africa and to increase trade integration within Africa, because I think that really is key. And there, unfortunately, you see a lot of barriers such that Will was talking about. Now, turning to crop insurance, let me be the first one to say, an individual-based crop insurance program is prohibitively expensive, I think. That even in a rich country like the U.S., crop insurance would not exist without subsidies, massive subsidies. Now, clearly there are types of insurance like hail insurance that exist in commercial markets, and I think those are potentials. What you do see of interest, I think, to developing countries is, one, the sort of experimentation, I would say, of using index products. Now, an index products, if you think of, say, looking at a rainfall insurance or the yields over a large region, not your farm, but the entire region, those can be done at a much lower cost because, just for the reasons Will was mentioning, you diversify. It's not a single farm yield, which can be very variable, but a large region, which tends to be less variation. And because of that, the cost tends to be much, much less than individual based. But a big problem, there's a huge disparity between your yield and the regional yield, or even the rainfall index at the weather station, which is 30 miles from your farm. And so what people have looked at or thought about is, can these products like weather insurance, index insurance, be offered at more aggregators of risk? So could these be perhaps insurance that could be provided to credit facilitators, so that the creditors who are giving loans to a lot of people in the area and have the regional yield is what is important in one sense to those? And so I think there's some potential there. But I think it's very clear, and I would say precisely what I think is behind your question, that as a solution, this is not a good one for developing countries, and frankly, not a good one for developed countries. I'd like to see less subsidies in those products. I think that they should go back to kind of what they were intended on in providing yield protection, catastrophic protection, and shouldn't be clouded with price support or things like that.
Thank you. Okay, the biggest problems for food security, war and violence. It's unrelated to policies, trade. It's war and violence. Clearly, if you look at the countries that are suffering from problems, it's war and violence. And I relate to the first question, the person from Norway that left. There are some indicators of concentration, and if you look also at the numbers that Will showed, now you have more developing countries trading. So the indicators that I saw of concentration calculated from a guy from OECD, in fact, show more diversification, not more concentration of exports. And the food security situation at the world level is improving. Food production per capita has increased in all the regions. There are countries still with problems, but mostly are food and in violence and war. And you have all the indicators of malnutrition, wasting, children, mortality, and so on and so forth. They are all coming down. So I would say that. Then, and the lady from Germany, there you are. No, I'm not saying that you can change 86, 88, but you can define, if you put in your original numbers, you put your currency, now you can include, in my view, the same value, 86, 88 in dollars, or in special drawing rights, or in your constant currency, because the Annex 3 doesn't say anything about that. And you have to take into account your constituency, initial papers that you presented, but you have to do it not necessarily according to that. That's what the Korean beef case defined. And yeah, no, policies cost money. Protection costs money. The only thing is that it's paid by the consumer, and the producer receives that. So all the policies cost money, in one way or another. The question is who's paying it, and how effective is if your policy for the objectives that you wanted to achieve.
I didn't have anything on mega regional, sorry.
Just the lady who asked the question there about the key causes of food insecurity, war, violence, that's hugely important, and poverty. I mean, poverty and vulnerability, these are critical, and countries need to do an awful lot, mostly at the domestic level, to deal with that. But as Eugenio said, poverty rates have fallen. The achievements of the last 20 years have been stunning. I mean, we do have potentially the elimination of poverty as a credible target during the SDG time period. This is fantastic. We're living in wonderful times.
Well, on this optimistic note, given that there are other sessions that are going to come, let me try to close here without necessarily trying to summarize any of the things. I think, as Joe mentioned, all these papers will be published early next year and will be widely available. So we really look forward to have this analysis. Before you leave, I'm told to remind you to fill this feedback survey. That's always very useful for us to understand how to improve the organization of such events. And with this, let me again thank IFPRI and all our three speakers, and please join me in applauding them for their good presentations. Thank you very much.